Hey, everybody. Welcome to Exploring the Wine Glass, sponsored by Dracena Wines. I am your host, Lori, a UC Davis winemaking and WSET Level 2 graduate. Today on Allure of the Pour, I am sitting down with David Meadows, owner, founder, producer of Pure Wine. And I'd like you to uncork, unscrew, savor your favorite bottle, and sit down and enjoy the conversation as we talk about a product that could help people who have allergies or inadvertent reactions to wine, help them enjoy it more easily. So welcome, David.
I'm glad to join you. This will be a fun conversation, I'm sure.
Yeah, thank you. So my very first question is, you know, I really don't know very much about you, and I honestly had never heard of the product prior before your email to me about it. So let's first start off with you. Let's get a little bit of information about yourself, your background, and how did your background lead you to Pure Wine?
So really, I'll start at the point where you always say that necessity is the mother of invention, and that's really what happened with me. About 10 years ago, 12 years ago, I enjoyed drinking wine and really didn't have much of an issue with it, but I started having problems. I started having issues with some really heavy Bordeaux-style wines to where I would have a half a glass or a glass of a red wine. And some of them, I'd lose my voice entirely for 30 minutes, and I couldn't talk. And I'd be nasal congestion. I'd wake up the next morning with a headache. And it really came to a head. One of my very close friends, he owns a leading winery in Washington State, and he had had me over for dinner. And I sat down with him and his family, and he was, you know how winemakers will be there. You say, this is my pride and joy bottle of wine here. And, you know, you're supposed to sit there and say, oh, boy, this is going to be very good. Well, it was a luxurious bottle of wine, and it was close to a four-digit value for the bottle, so it was a very expensive bottle. And I drank a half a glass, and I couldn't talk the rest of the night. So my background being a PhD in biomedical engineering and doing a lot of medical device, heading research groups and also pharmaceutical groups, I kind of knew what was going on because I knew I hadn't overconsumed. People will say, well, you've overconsumed. It was just an issue. You drank too much when you had a headache the next day or the nasal congestion. I knew that wasn't the case. And it was a classic H1, H2 kind of phenomena. H, that meaning a histamine response. I don't want to go too much into the pharmacology of it, but let's just say that that's what happens when you have allergic type responses. And each person has a different response to these histamine kinds of things. You may get a headache from it. You may get nasal congestion. Other people get skin flush, and it usually starts from about the chest up and moves up to your head. You'll get the red ears. Other people get really bad GI distress, and all those are histamine-mediated response, classic H1, H2, even H3 kind of responses. And I said to myself, I'm going to figure out what was going on. And I was still in big industry kind of thing, so I couldn't do anything at the point then. But I started researching it, and I started, at that point, everybody was pointing to sulfites being the issue. But then, you know, us being scientists, we know what the scientific method is. If you've got red wines that have 10 part per million sulfites, and you've got white wines that have 150 part per million sulfites, and I didn't have any problems with white wines. It was the red wines that caused me problems. I said, it's not the sulfite, stupid. And so for me, but yet other people do. And so I think the biggest thing I learned early on is to be very humble and not presupposing people's responses, because when you work in allergy-type products, which I did for many years, is that everybody is a unique human being. And their pharmacology, their bioavailability, and we'll get into some of that here to help explain what we've learned, is that each person's different. And that person's pharmacology changes as they age. So you may have someone who at 25 has no problems drinking wine, but Northern European, red-haired, green-eyed, blonde-haired, blue-eyed female, peri and post-menopausal, she may wake up to where she can't drink red wines at all anymore. And we can get into the pharmacology of what happens with that, because a lot of these reactions are estrogen or testosterone linked kinds of responses. So that kind of got me going. And so to answer your question, after one of my companies had been bought out, I decided I'm going to go out and solve this problem. So I had a son who just graduated from college. His name is Derek, and he had started doing craft beer making on our kitchen table and at our kitchen stove. And he started having problems with some of the beers he was creating, to where he could, it would literally choke him, to where his throat would tighten, and he couldn't drink some of his double and triple IPAs. And so he just said, "Dad, let's start a company to solve this problem." And that's really where we started with Pure Wine. So about 6 years ago, we went developed a lab in, we live in Dallas, Texas, and we rented a lab in a local university. And through this series of experiments, we found out what were the key ingredients that were in wine, naturally in wine. And there's nothing wrong with the wine. It's just that certain people historically or from the diseases or syndromes that they have, they can't drink these wines anymore. And that's really where we were, is that we found that these biogenic amines, that would be the histamines, and the sulfites are the predominant causes of these side effects that people have. And each person being unique, we'll have to determine which ones of these they're sensitive to, and will that change based on age and based on sex and ethnicity. So with that, we started the company. We launched our first product 3 years ago. It just took off. We picked up by the Doctor Show and a bunch of other TV programs, because it's a really big problem. We've been staring people straight in the face for many years, and the stories that we hear have just been amazing. From different people who enjoy our products. So I guess that's really how it got started, was to solve a problem both Derek and I had.
And so I have told many people, preaching to them that, they're like, I used to be able to do this, and not necessarily drinking wine, but anything. I used to be able to eat this, and now I can't eat it anymore. I used to be able to drink this, and I can't drink it anymore. I never had hay fever. Now I have hay fever. And I try to explain to them that your bio, you are a chemical makeup, and that biochemistry is changed and altered. And, they say it's on average of every 7 years, but it's always an ebb and flow type thing. So it is very realistic that somebody who was able to drink wine without a problem, then at some point in their life, then later cannot drink it, or never had hay fever, never had an allergy to mold, and find themselves one day waking up and, hey, now I have seasonal hay fever. So I get where you're coming from, and I'm sorry that happened, but that is definitely scientifically true. Your body changes, and things that you were able to tolerate, you no longer can. And I think the best.
The old words they used to say was they were age onset allergies. Remember that terminology? And that's really what we're describing here. But yet, these aren't really allergies, because what you're doing is that you're being exposed to histamines. That's what we find. And if you go to the literature, the wine literature, it's been known for a long time that histamines, so you've got the biogenic amines, the ones that are the predominant ones, are the histamine, putrescine, cadaverine, and tyramine. Those are the classic ones. And you can have high concentrations of those in some of the heavy Bordeaux-style wines, the Tempranillo, Syrah, those kinds of grapes just naturally have a lot of histamines in them, because it's the precursors are the amino acids that are in the skin proteins. And if you have a really thick skin, you're going to have a lot of these proteins that have, and there's nothing wrong with the grapes, it's just that that's the way they're biochemistry is of these grape skins.
Yes, and tyramine is very high in a lot of the, like you said, the thick skinned, the deep mm-hmm. grapes. On your site, it mentions that 75% of all wine drinkers suffer from wine intolerance. So I guess I can classify myself as being very lucky, because 75% is rather high, and I don't get any side effects whatsoever. And with my skin tone, the Irishness, we tend to get flush, and I don't even get that. What research led you to come to that number of 75% suffering from wine tolerance, and what exactly are you classifying as a wine intolerance?
The way we did this, we did four different nationwide surveys. These were all conducted. These were age matched, being from this pharmaceutical and medic device world. I've done a lot of clinical work, and so we did a lot of biostatistical screening of people. And these were all internet type surveys. They were all age matched, geographic matched, a male and female kind of surveys. And you'll see that it's actually up to 75%. And so what we found is that what you'll find is that in the younger population, you don't find it near that. It may be 10 to 15%. And it's going to be biased, again, to female population. 85% of all of our customers are female. And it's really the key demographic there is 35 to 55. That's where most of our customers are. And what it is, and it's because for women particularly, I've already mentioned, is that once you get close to menopause in that 35 to 45 age group, estrogen is a cofactor for the biogenic amine enzyme that's used to break them down. It's called diamine oxidase. And that diamine oxidase actually is what breaks down the histamines in your body. And if your diamine oxidase activity is impacted by estrogen levels, it actually downregulates the effectiveness of that enzyme. So that's why when we end up looking at that, we found that as people age, that percentage keeps going up and up and up. Okay. And also, it's very important on the demographic. We find that groups of people like Mediterranean people, that is a low frequency. They grew up drinking red wine, these heavy Mediterranean-style wines. You go to Northern European, like the English, the Irish, the Scandinavians, or you go to Asians, or you go to African Americans, where their ethnicity, they didn't grow up drinking fruit-derived wines. They have a high frequency for this also. It's an intolerance. It's not a true allergy. It's an intolerance to the histamines that are in the liquid form that you're drinking.
Right. Okay. So that does make sense because it is a direct relationship between the estrogen. No, I guess that would be an indirect because as your estrogen levels lower, the histamines do not get broken down as much.
That's right.
So that's a direct relationship. Got to go back to my college days, whatever, high school. So that direct relationship. So it does make sense that it changes as you get older and as a female is being more approaching perimenopause or menopause itself. So
see those autoimmune type things that a lot of women unfortunately encounter, and it's all linked to that same kind of phenomena, is that you'll find people, women who get arthritis, the rheumatoid arthritis that kicks in, and red wine is one of the worst accelerators of that, or they get migraine headaches. The leading trigger for migraine headaches is red wine, by far, and you just have to ask, why is that? And it's because the histamines are vasodilators, and for women, histamine is actually a neurotransmitter, so that actually stimulates these migraine headaches that women will often encounter with red wine. And so I guess that's what we've learned, is that we don't try and say anything's bad about that. We just try and educate people, is that that's a natural process of fermentation. Histamines have been in red wine for 9,000 years. They're going to be in red wine for another 9,000 years. You're going to need to use sulfites in wine to get good preservation and high quality. You're going to need, the Romans started 2,000 years ago doing it. We're going to probably still be using it for another 2,000 years. So we're just trying to make it to where people who need to have those removed from the wine to enjoy it, to where they can have a really nice product that will do that for them.
So I'm going to get a little bit into some science and I'm honestly glad to hear that you're talking more about the histamines than the sulfites, because you know, as I mentioned, as a wine lover, as a winemaker, as a biologist, the whole sulfite thing drives me honestly crazy. I have friends, I have relatives who sit there and claim that they cannot drink red wine because they are allergic to sulfites, and that, you know, they can drink the white wine, but it's the red wine that does it. And I keep trying to explain to them.
Those myths. The myths live on, don't they? It's amazing.
They're much more difficult to break than, you know, than people want to listen to the truth. But as we know that scientifically, there's actually more sulfites in the white than in the red. And although there are people who are allergic, physically allergic to sulfites, that is actually a very small population. It tends to be 1% of the asthmatic population in the world. So now you figure all of the people in the world break down to only the people who have asthma, and then only about 1% of that. So just your product claims to take out the sulfites, and is that basically just for that 1% of that population, or are you trying to guide that, you know, that, because they are two completely different things, histamines and sulfites. So I'm just trying to see how you got them to come together.
Sure. Let's back up. You're exactly right when you're talking about an anaphylactic response, and we're going to talk about some of the immunological spectrum, is that it's not bimodal. I mean, it's not a zero or a one, these allergy-type responses. You'll have on the very far end, you'll have the asthmatic, anaphylactic people, who it can really be causing them to have deathly experiences. You can have the other people who, and I've met them, you've probably met them too, when they drink a white wine, a sweet white wine that has a high sulfite content, their mouth, and I've gotten lots of comments from people, their mouth swells, they get really red lips, they get deathly bad headaches from it. That's not an anaphylactic response, but it is a local inflammatory response in their mouths. So I guess the key concept, and that's where we'll have to have our scientific discussion here, is that sulfite intolerance is very real. I have that for some white wines, and I'll go into explaining some of the experiments we've done to help shed some light on this spectrum, because it's a spectrum that people will have. Some people are very sensitive to sulfites. It's not an anaphylactic response, but they're just sensitive, just like they are with sulfa drugs. You don't necessarily die from sulfa drugs. I'm very sensitive to sulfa drugs. I develop hives all over my body. Doesn't mean I die from them, but I'm sensitive to them. I have an immunological response to them. It's usually a H1 response, and you know if it's an H1 response, if Benadryl works for you.
Right.
And that's how, that's the differential diagnosis, is if Benadryl works for you to where you get hives or some skin flushing, then it's a classic H1. It's not an anaphylactic response. Then you need usually some sort of antibody kind of treatment for that.
Right.
Does that help get started in that conversation?
Yes, because I just, my real thing to these people, so a relative who shall remain nameless, constantly has argued with my husband and myself that she has a sulfite allergy. Mm-hmm. Yet she drinks white wine, not red wine, so she avoids the red wine, right? She pours ketchup on every type of food product that she eats, which has more sulfites in it. She eats dried apricots, dried fruits, and all of these products have significantly more sulfite in it than that red wine does. But I do agree with you, and scientifically I'm agreeing with you that there is that spectrum. There's the anaphylactic, which is the asthmatic, and then just as anybody can be sensitive to something, the sulfur intolerance is there. But as you mentioned, it's when you're drinking more of the white wine than the red. And I think a large population blames red wine for their headaches, for all of that, when it's not the sulfites mm-hmm. that are causing that.
Right. So we'll pause now and say we're in complete agreement at that point. Okay, good. And so here's what I did after that, because I couldn't believe the myths out there because the science didn't match up. So what we did, and Derek helped with these experiments, is that we went out and bought, and I've actually bought these again today for people. Okay, here you go. Okay, these are some mangoes, dried mangoes. Okay, I also bought some other kinds of apricots here. And what I'm going to show you is the effect of when you do and you don't. These are what apricots look like when you have sulfites on them. Okay? They're nice and fresh. What happens when you don't have sulfites on them for your audience? Okay? We've all probably seen an organic one. Looks like something you pick up behind your dog, doesn't it? Okay? So who wants to eat an unsulfided apricot? So what, and those are good. They're good for you. The issue, though, and this is why I hopefully the audience doesn't get too impatient with us, but we need to talk the science behind it. Sulfites are basically three types of sulfites. You've got free sulfites, you've got bound sulfites, and that gives you the total sulfites, right? You as winemakers know that. How do you measure total sulfites? You first measure free sulfites, then you acidify it with hydrogen chloric acid so that you drive down the pH, you shift the equilibrium to, well, whatever sulfites were bound onto proteins or whatever materials are freed up at a low pH below 1, and now you can measure the total sulfites that are in a wine. That does not work for solids. That's what, and if you look at our website, you'll see a blog that I wrote that discusses this. We did an experiment on mangoes and also on apricots about 2 years ago where I acidified these dried mangoes that had a lot of sulfites used on them. And when you acidify them, you cannot free any of the sulfites off of the surface. That's why they don't turn brown. They're bound. They're chemically bound. So that's the differential thing that needs to be understood when we talk about sulfite. In wine, you have a usually between 50 to 125 part per million of free sulfites when you put them in your mouth, correct? That's white wine is that. And so when they're free, that means that they're in solution and are able to be absorbed in your, the term we use in sort of the medical science, in the mucosal lining of your mouth. That's called the buccal and the sublingual regions of your mouth. Those go directly into your bloodstream. Anything that is absorbed from the neck up goes directly into your bloodstream. It bypasses your liver, so you don't get it detoxed. So that's why you will have a really rapid response to nitroglycerin tablets. That's why you put it under your tongue. If you swallow nitroglycerin, it gets inactivated in your gut. And the same thing has to be realized when you drink wine. Wine is not a solid. And so therefore, when you talk about ketchup, it may have a lot of sulfites used in it, but they're not free sulfites. You can't absorb them into your mouth when you do that. So the worst thing, I say the worst, but it talks about drug delivery and bioavailability. When you swirl wine in your mouth, the histamines and the sulfites go directly into your bloodstream, and they're not detoxed by your liver. So for me, that is one of the most important things that I learned, is if you want to bypass that, drink wine with a straw. You guzzle it. You get it into your gut, and you will be able to detox those quickly in the gut. So for sulfites, I come back to that. We did that experiment, and we found that when you work with solids, they can be either leafy green vegetables at a salad bar. It could be these packaged dried fruit. It can be ketchups. That's the wrong experiment. It's actually a misdirection. You can't apply solid chemistry to liquid chemistry. And so we're trying to get that message out, and so hopefully that will be part of this podcast will help with that. And so it comes back to basic wine chemistry, is that you have to understand the difference between free sulfites and bound sulfites. Because once the pH of your mouth is around 6 to 7.5, so any sulfites that are in your mouth are actually going to be bound to the food, the fruit, and it's not going to come off of the fruit and go into your mouth. So did that make sense, Lori? Because it's really important to understand the difference, and it's really bioavailability. Is the sulfites aren't bioavailable in solids that have had, because they're immobilized. They aren't free any longer.
Yeah, no, that makes a lot of sense, and it does explain a lot to people who are listening, everything. It was a nice, easy explanation of free versus bound and total sulfite, which I wish it was that easy to just do that while we're doing wine making. that was not a fun portion for me of the wine making program. My husband is a food chemist, so it was very simple to him. But I'm much more biology than the chemistry. Okay, so going along with the...
Can I go on one more?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I have one more thought, because to help your friend who was trying to figure this out, the other thing that we learned is the difference in wines such as champagnes and Proseccos that have carbon dioxide. Because the sulfites are actually volatile, You can determine whether you're going to have problems with a particular wine, and actually went out and bought a wine, so I can show your audience how to do that. This is, I won't use the brand name, it's a sweet Riesling.
Okay.
So what I learned by a person who has, and he's a very distinct, people would know his name if I mentioned it, but I won't. He's a well-known wine writer. He says he can't drink white wine at all because of the sulfites. He knew exactly what you and I were talking about, that white wines have higher sulfites, and he also can't drink champagnes. And so he and I were talking around dinner one night, and he says what he always does is he starts with a room temperature white wine, and he shakes it up. Then he just opens up the lid, and he immediately puts his nose over it. Okay, if he smells wine, he knows that there's low sulfites in there. But if he ends up sneezing or coughing or he has a burning smell in that, he can tell the sulfites right off the top. And it's the volatile sulfites that he's talking about. So particularly for champagnes, what I've told people who have sulfite intolerances, champagne, some of the sweet champagnes can be really, they can cause a lot of these pseudo-allergies for people. So what I encourage people to do is let it aerate. Let the carbon dioxide sweep. We call it a sweep gas in the engineering terminology. The CO2 will actually eliminate the sulfites out of the wine. It will evaporate out of a champagne. So that sweep gas, if you want to evaporate off the sulfites so they won't give you as many side effects, you can let it. Unfortunately, it starts getting flat.
So you
do lose the effervescence on that, but that will help. And that's the other reason a good, if you let a wine that has some sulfites in it, you put it in a carafe and let it aerate really well, you can help drive off some of the sulfites too.
Okay, and I'm curious, now we're talking about the carbon dioxide, thinking, a large number of people still drink their sparkling wines out of flutes. And that's really just taking all of that carbon, all of that, the carbon dioxide, all of the bubbles, sending it and really focusing it in onto your nasal cavity, which is what people enjoy about sparkling, but maybe even just changing the glass they're drinking out of, if could have a beneficial effect on them, if you're using a coupe or you're, a wide mouth wine glass might have a little benefit to it.
I would think it would, and so that sweep gas, they call it sweep gas, or the sparging of that CO2 through the champagne will help to remove quite a bit of the sulfite so that you won't have so much of a side effect from it.
Excellent. So let's go back to the histamines, because that really is in my opinion, the much larger offender. So just for my listeners, you know, scientifically, histamine is basically just a compound which is released by an injury or an allergic or inflammatory reaction. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's, like you were mentioning, H1, H2, but most people recognize a histamine or are related to a histamine in terms of their seasonal hay fevers. And as you mentioned, Benadryl, and that's that H1, you know, if you have hay fever, you take a Benadryl, it's going to help you, or that type of thing. So let's go, can you go a little bit more into how that histamine is acting and why it's affecting the people who are drinking wine?
Yes, and so I think first of all, how do you get histamines into your body? Is that I go back to the whole concept of the bioavailability in your mouth, is that you need to have the enzymes that are able to remove histamines from your body be exposed to those histamines. And they only exist in the gut and in the liver and the digestive systems. They're actually produced, these enzymes, in association with your gut and your liver. So therefore, if you drink a red wine and you swirl it in your mouth and it goes directly into your blood system and it bypasses the liver, those histamines just get circulating throughout your body without going to the liver first. So that's really important to understand, that I don't think people say, well, why do certain red wines give me problems and others don't? And we did a lot of studies. We actually worked with a leading wine testing lab in Napa to do all of our testing to make sure that we were removing the histamines. And we looked across the globe, South America, North America, Europe, even South Africa, Australia. We looked at all the leading varietals, and we assessed these with the histamine and sulfite when we were developing our product, because we wanted to make sure that it wasn't going to be specific to a particular varietal. And what we discovered during that time is that the Europeans have really been ahead of us in this. For about 20 years, there's been 9 countries that have had restrictions on histamine in wine. And so the leading one is actually Switzerland. It still has that on the books. You cannot have any more than 2 part per million histamine in wines and have them imported into Switzerland. So you've got Germany, France, the Netherlands, Spain, Italy, all of those have restrictions on histamine. That's only histamine. It's not any of the other biogenic amines. What we found is that putrescine particularly is the highest, and that's dependent on the quality of the grape, the age of the grape, how long you let it stay on the vine. All of those will be dependent on how much histamine, putrescine, cadaverine, and tyramine, and the mixture that you have by that grape. And if you can actually know what you're sensitive to, of which one of those biogenic amines, what we've found is that the putrescine seems to be more associated with throat tightness and congestion. The histamines are more of a vasodilator. So those, if you've got vascular or headache-driven issues, that's where that is. Skin, we haven't really assessed that, because a lot of fair-complected women will get that rash, you know, like you were saying, Irish. That's what we find. And so one of the most important things we ask women or men before we start a conversation with them, do they take an allergy medication already? And that's what I would ask you. Do you take any allergy medications already?
No.
You do? Okay. And so, because if that person does, the way they answer the questions is going to be totally different. Okay. Because they've already diminished their exposure to histamines. They've already, the antihistamines are already inactivating the histamines that they have in their diet. So if they don't take the antihistamines anymore, all of a sudden they'll have inability to drink wine.
Okay. So, yeah, I'm lucky. I do not have any issues like that at all. So I'm very lucky. I am deathly allergic to strawberries. Give me a strawberry and my throat will close, and I start with the rash right at the chest, and it goes right up. So it is a classic it is a classic symptom. But you know, mm-hmm. I'm not taking an allergy pill to potentially eat a strawberry one day. You know,
right? You don't eat that kind of a strawberry, right?
I just stay far away. Anything that's red, my husband, we joke that he really could do me in, because if we go out to dinner and we have something that's got some sort of red, you know, decorative thing on it, you know, how they always like the presentation, I always make him taste it, and you know, he's like, no, it's raspberry, and I'm like, okay, and I'm like, you know, I really do have a lot of trust in you, because those little things that can really
you understand that.
I'm sorry, what?
So let me I think I'd like to show, I purposely put this little chart behind me. And those who are in the wine area will recognize it. This is DeLong's varietal chart. And what we did is that when we did our testing, I'm going to step off to the side here so that it can be seen. So what we did is that we tested these that are down in here. You go, these would be the Grenaches. Those who aren't familiar with this, this would be the Syrahs over here to the Montevedras. And what we found was exactly that. These that are down in this area, Cabernet Sauvignon, the Merlots, those are the classic thick skin grapes that we found high levels of these biogenic amines in them. The Mediterranean style warm weather grapes that are going to be higher in biogenic amines. And if you are a person who's sensitive to red wine, these are the ones that are going to be most problematic for you. And what you want to do is you want to shift up. And that's why people shift. They know from themselves, they shift up towards the white wines, because these are lower in histamines. But what we found is some of the cool weather, Pinot Noir, some of the thinner grapes, those usually work really well for people. Because I can still drink a cool weather Pinot Noir pretty well without any side effects. So I'm really of a mild intolerance to red wines. But you give me a heavy Cabernet that's been grown in a real warm region, I'll have problems with it, and I'll end up with a headache and the nasal congestion. It's almost universal for me. That I just can't drink Cabernets without using our product to remove the histamines. And so now I just use our products every time.
Okay. So the last thing that I wanted to get into before we actually start really talking about your product and how the product works is tannins. Because tannins mm-hmm. is another problem for people. It does tend to lead it boosts the production of serotonin, and then the change in the serotonin levels triggers headaches, and those who are prone to migraines, that's really where a lot of it comes into. So have you done any research into terms of tannins and what that can do to the people that have that are claiming they have the intolerance, and does your product account for that at all?
So we had read that literature also, and so we explored that very thoroughly. So throughout all of our testing, we tested the four biogenic amines before and after being treated. We also tested it for the classic phenolics that would be in white wines and in red wines. And what we found is that with our particular technology, we removed none of the tannins out of these wines. The chemistry doesn't work on tannins, and we felt like we wanted to keep the tannins in because it was really important to keep the quality of the wine. And what we found is that I don't have any reactions to tannins. I don't think tannins is an issue, personally. Tannins, as we know, are macromolecules, meaning they're high molecular weight. The bioavailability of tannins that are 100,000 Daltons is zero. They aren't bioavailable in your mouth or in your gut. Your body doesn't respond to them. Anything higher than about 500 molecular weight is not bioavailable in your mucosal lining. So with that, I said this is a red herring. This is another red herring for most of the people. Tannins will not be the issue because we literally remove none of the tannins and the side effects go away. So you can do that scientific method with this, is that you do it where you remove the histamines, none of the tannins, and you have your side effects go away. you don't use our product, you keep the histamines in, and you can challenge yourself again, and you get the headaches again. So it doesn't mean that there aren't some people who are sensitive to the tannins, but it's going to be a different kind of mechanism because they aren't bioavailable in your mouth, and they aren't bioavailable in your gut until you break them down. You have to digest them to a molecular weight where they are absorbable in your body.
Okay, very cool. All right, so in your video on your website, it says that your product focuses on the 4 histamines and 2 sulfites that trigger the side effects. So everything has been very scientific, and I'm loving it. So what did you actually do that tested to narrow down to just these 4 histamines or these 2 sulfites?
It really wasn't us that we looked at the literature, and those are actually the assays that you get when you test. You go to wine testing labs, and they'll test for those 4 biogenic amines. There's actually 12 biogenic amines that can form in wine, but the leading ones are just the 4 that we talked about. So those are the ones that we focused on, of trying to remove those. And it took a lot of effort. We were in the lab more than a year to try and figure out how to do that. We ended up having 2 products. We had a product that was able to remove the sulfites really well. And again, it was the free sulfites. Those were the ones. We removed quite a bit of the total if you had the right chemistry there. But what we found is that another product would remove the histamines. And it was Derek. He said, "Dad, we can't have 2 products. You can't have 2 different products. People are going to be out on the town. They're going to want to have a white wine, and then they're going to have a red wine, and you're going to tell them to take 2 different products." And he said, "It's not going to work." So I listened to him. He said, "You're exactly right." So we went back to the lab, and we tried to put those chemistries into one product. And it took us quite a bit of effort. We had to retune the proprietary chemistry to where you could get both of them to work, to where you would remove the sulfites and the histamines simultaneously in no matter what wine you use it in. So that was really the aha moment for us. And when we were able to show that, and we worked with, again, the leading lab in the Napa Valley area. You probably know who I'm talking about. And they were very, very helpful for us, and they confirmed all of our testing. It wasn't us who did the testing, the analytical testing. It was working in an independent third-party lab that did that. And then once we got the chemistry where it worked, we then had it tested in a sommelier school in Florida. I won't give the name of that, but it's one of the leading sommelier schools there, where they tested it in totally blind taste testings, to where it was with a group of sommeliers. It was a group of lay people. And what we asked them to do is use 3 different kinds of wines and do the classic ABC testing on them. Okay. And they did a very elaborate study with them, and there was no distinct difference between that. And you have forced choice to where you ask those populations, which do you prefer? And 2-1, they preferred the treated wine.
Okay. Awesome.
And we would say that that's because you've taken out some of the bitterness from the sulfites and the histamines out of that.
Okay.
So, go ahead. So
going back a little bit, from how long did it take you to go from concept to product?
It took about a year, really, to get it. Because we learned very easily, it's very easy to how to destroy wine. You can make it because our particular technology has 5 different components in it. So we had to find the right ratios there to where we would remove certain things, the sulfites and the histamine, but not remove any of the tannins. We didn't want to remove any of the resveratrol or quercetin, any of the classic things that you want to keep in wine that are providing the healthy benefits to it. And so for us, that was very important. We didn't want to change the color. We didn't want to change some of the organoleptic properties of the wine.
Okay, so I know it's a proprietary compound. So to the best that you can, is it a binding product? Is it, how is it physically doing it, because we're not having any reverse osmosis going on. We're not having anything like this. So how does your product actually remove these histamines and sulfites?
It's a selective binding, and it's an equilibrium phenomena that you have to set up. That's where it was really important, and my engineering background came in very handy with that, because you have to form an equilibrium that exists to where you can remove the things that you want and not that you want to remove certain things and you want to keep certain things in there. So you have to set up an equilibrium in that chemistry. And that was really, it's all absorption chemistry. So we didn't want to put anything into the wine. It's very important. For me, I felt like you don't want to go start putting things into wine because you don't know what the reactions are going to always be. Because there's some products out there that put hydrogen peroxide into wine, the drops or the little sticks. And man, if you've used those, you know what I'm talking about. You go over one drop too many and all of a sudden it tastes like hydrogen peroxide.
Right.
So we tested those early on and I said, that's not the way I want to develop a product. I want to develop a product that is strictly removing the bad things that you don't want to have for that particular customer, leaving everything else in, and not putting anything into the wine. That was really important to us to design a product.
Okay, so organoleptically, it's basically some compound that's in your product, and it draws the molecules of the histamine and sulfites towards it to create that equilibrium, and then traps it by binding it?
Yes, exactly right. So let me open one up so your audience can see. This was our first product, Lori, and I'm not here to do a big pitch or anything, but I think it'll help people to see what you're talking about. This is a product that we call the wand. We tried to put it into a format that you can see. I'll just get it up close to it.
There you go, yes.
We've got the chemistry in this little sort of teabag type pocket there. And there's enough in there to where you can do one glass of wine, because that's what we wanted to do, is to have it convenient for people to where you'll have your glass of wine and you just swirl it in here for a couple of minutes. It takes about 3 minutes to remove 50% of the sulfites and 50% of the histamines. You keep it in 8 or 9 minutes, you'll remove 95% of the histamines. It's classic kinetics. It's just asymptotically, the kinetics goes down. You leave it in an infinite amount of time and it'll go to zero. Classic first order kinetics that exists there for this absorption. So you just swirl it in there. You don't have to swirl it like that. You just need the gradual movement of that, because this is a very porous bag there.
Right.
You can see it. The wine percolates through it very easily as an absorbed in the little absorbent particles that are inside that.
So does the person who is using this product, they're at the table, and their wine is served in their glass. Do they have to constantly do a little swirl, or is it just a quick swirl to get it going and then they can let it sit while they converse or start their dinner or do whatever?
It's intermittent is all you need, Lori, because any liquid will continue to swirl. We don't see it in a microscopic level, but you just swirl it, and it'll keep swirling for a couple of minutes just from the viscosity. And again, the scientific explanation for it. But so you just, what we find, and it depends on the individual. Some people like to just play with it. You know, some people, it's kind of like a tea bag. Some people will dip their tea bag time and time again. Other people just like to let it steep. And we don't have we just say swirl it and let it stay there. That's how I use it. And then I swirl it a little bit, maybe 10 seconds, 15 seconds later. And then I take it out. Sometimes I take it out and I put it on my plate. Other times I just keep it in and I drink the wine like that. So there is no wrong way to use it, and there's no wrong way to how long you keep it in. If you've got a really severe problem, and what's exciting, and I'm going to back up a little bit, Lori, because this is more of a personal vignette for you, is that we've found hundreds, literally thousands of people who have written to us about people who we're working with, some of the leading migraine headache organizations in the world now that are advocating our product. We're in the Cleveland Clinics, health and wellness clinics, to where they're advocating it for people who have histamine intolerance kinds of issues. And if you look that up, you'll look under HIT, histamine intolerance, And that's really the broader umbrella of what I'm talking about here, is that people develop that, whether you've got a syndrome or a disease. You can have Crohn's, you can have rheumatoid arthritis, you can have irritable bowel syndrome. All of those are going to be exacerbated by histamine in your diet. So I lecture at different meetings of the migraine headache societies and some of the national meetings and allergy meetings on this very subject of histamine intolerance. And so I say that's really the humility that I've had to learn along the way here, is that because everybody is different, they'll have different levels of being able to remove histamines and the role of histamine in their particular disease or syndrome.
Okay. So now, let's say that product here, I looked up on Amazon, you sell them by like 10 packs or 18?
Eight packs on Amazon. Eight. Yeah, Amazon's a little bit different mix that we have. Three packs and eight packs and 24 packs.
Okay. So if I'm sitting down, I'm out to dinner with my husband, and this is what I have, but we bring a whole bottle of wine. So am I using three of these, or is that one product going to be able to get me through my bottle of wine sharing with my husband or sharing with friends?
It's going to depend. If you've got really bad symptoms of wine intolerance or histamine intolerance, we recommend you use one of the wines per glass. For me, though, mine are rather mild. I can usually do two glasses of wine. Okay. I don't like telling this because it encourages people to be misuse a product, but if you don't have real bad histamine problems, you can use the wand for a couple of glasses or a large, what we call a Texas pour, you know, like a Texas size pour, 10 ounces or something like that. So there, we did over design the product with people in mind who are really intolerant. But we also came out with another product, Lori, that I wanted to show just because for the very question that you asked, is that we have a product that you put on a bottle here. It's called the Wave. The other one was the Wand, and this is a Wave. And this was our whole bottle product. You put it on the bottle, and you just pour the bottle, and it filters as you pour.
Oh, okay.
So for some people, that's more convenient than a single wand. For me, I drink a couple of glasses, so I don't. My wife's not much of a wine drinker, and so we don't consume a whole bottle. So we won't use the Wave very often. We use the wand every time we drink a glass of wine because she's really sensitive. She's Scandinavian, so she's blonde hair, blue-eyed, and so she has to have wands to be able to drink wine because of her ethnic background.
So going back to the Wave, with the mm-hmm. wand, you say that you recommend keeping it in for 3 minutes or so in order to remove the histamines and sulfites. If I just put this in there, now it's got a filter up on top, it looks like you had mentioned. So is this automatic?
Yep.
Is it immediate?
What we find is it takes about 10 to 15 seconds to filter a glass of wine with that. But because we have four times as much of the absorbent that we do in the, I'm trying to find the wand here so you can compare the size. Somehow I misplaced it. But there it is. It's in the glass. So what we did was that we compare the sizes of them. There's four times as much of the absorbent in here as there is in this.
Okay.
And so every drop of wine that comes from the bottle goes through four times as much resin. So you get a very high exposure. And when you're swirling this in a glass of wine, it's only exposed to a tiny portion of the glass. So it's very inefficient relative to the bottle. We get that question a lot, so I wanted to go into that explanation of how you can have super efficient kinds of absorption where it only takes 15 seconds to filter a glass, while when you've got this kind of it takes literally 3 minutes to do that. It's just because you've got a whole glass of wine here and this is only exposed to a tiny amount.
Surface area
to volume kind of explanation. Exactly right.
Okay, so how much do these products cost somebody?
So it's going to depend, as you could guess, if you're going to buy a large box, and this is the box that we have on our website. This is the largest package. This is a 30 count for the wands. We have also a 5 count. And this, if you buy this, it's going to be $10. It's going to be $2 a piece.
Okay.
If you buy this, it's $1.25 a piece. So it's used by volume. So
right.
It's only going to be $1.25 to treat one or two glasses of wine. It's very manageable for people. Because I've had so many people say, it's $1.25 for not having a headache or feeling lousy the next day is well worth it. And that's really the kind of economics that people do in their head all the time. They're saying, okay, if it was going to be $15 to not have a headache, it wouldn't be worth it. But $1.25, it's really worth. That kind of, they call it an insurance policy.
Right. I was just talking to a friend. My friend keeps trying to convince me to get Netflix. And mm-hmm. I'm like, I cannot bring myself to pay $14 a month for TV, like to watch shows on Netflix. And they're like, yeah, but you just spent $70 on a bottle of wine that you drink in one night. And I'm like, well, that's value to me. So. Absolutely.
You exactly hit it on the head, I think, Lori, is that we wanted to have different products for different use cases. And let people individually do the economics themselves. Because that's really, you need to put that level of decision making in the consumer's hands.
Because
they need to decide what is, if they want to come back into wine, start being able to drink wine again, it's a big deal for some people. That's what I've learned with these different people who have histamine intolerance. They often feel like they've been left behind. They'll go out into a social setting. And they have to drink water, or they drink a Coke, or something like that. And they'd much rather be able to share a nice glass of wine with their friends. And so, that you don't really appreciate how people feel sort of left out until you hear their stories. And now being able to join their friends once again in social settings is, they put a high value on them.
Absolutely.
A lot of people do.
And now, are those wands individually wrapped so somebody can just take it and stick it in a pocket or stick it in their purse? Or
that's exactly, this is what it comes at. It's all hermetically sealed. I'll open it up again. Well, I already opened up the other one. You can see we have an instruction card in there so people can see this is what it is, how to contact us, and then there's an actual instruction here on the back on how to use the product. And you get discounts, of course, as any good e-commerce company does. We will give you discounts, and you can tell your friends about it, and we'll give them discounts and stuff like that. So it becomes very economical for people. But most people will put it in their purse, or they'll call it a party pack. Okay, they'll put it in their purse and take it to parties with them, and it becomes really much of a conversation starter for people. That's what we've found is. Once you put it into the glass and you start swirling it, people will naturally come over and ask you, what are you doing?
Right.
It's kind of fun.
So that's really all of the questions I have, and I love all the science behind it and everything, but I just want to ask you, is there something that I've missed that you want the listeners to hear, whether it's a technical or a non-technical thing?
I think really just coming back to how we started off, Lori, is that there's a lot of myths out there of trying to explain things because you don't really understand as we age what's going on, or as we change our diets, why you can drink one glass of wine and not another glass of wine. And what we found is that giving this amount of information to people has been really powerful for people. We give them explanations. That they'll say, aha, I understand now why I can't drink red wine. And it really, that's, I think, one of the most gratifying things that we have. Or now that I used to be able to drink it, and now that I'm 45, I can't drink red wines, and I get really bad headaches. And you explain that to them, or why they can drink Pinot Noir from Willamette Valley, and they can't drink Tempranillo from Rioja or something. You know what I'm saying? That you really give people the kind of information that they can say, now I can start from something foundationally helpful.
Right. Where I can know. Make sense of what's happening to me.
They can start building that. So even your friend, now you can explain why the old folklore about the sulfated dried fruit is a poor example. It's a poor example to help the people understand the sensitivities to sulfites with that, because it has to do with chemistry that all winemakers know. It's bound versus free sulfite.
Right.
It comes back to basic chemistry of wine versus food chemistry, solid food chemistry.
Excellent. So are you ready to play my little game of opposites?
Sure. Let me take a deep breath, and there we go. We'll just sort of get in the groove here. Yeah.
Okay, so super, super simple. I'm just going to give you two terms. Whichever term you feel, resonates with you more, that's the answer, and it's the right answer. All right? We'll start off with non-food terms, and then, or non-wine terms, and then we'll move into some wine terms. Okay, so night or day?
Day.
Sunset or sunrise?
Sunrise.
Black or white?
Black.
Walk or run?
Run.
Food or drink?
Food.
Old world, new world?
Old world.
Sweet or dry?
Sweet.
Bubbles or still?
Bubbles.
Oak or stainless?
Wood. Oak.
Drink now or drink later?
Drink now.
Blend or varietal?
Varietal.
Vintage or non-vintage?
Vintage.
Cork or screw cap?
Cork.
Napa or Sonoma?
Sonoma.
Commercial or indigenous?
Indigenous.
Bordeaux or Rhone?
Rhone.
I was going to say, I think that I know your answer. And warm climate or cool climate?
Cool.
All right. Well, thank you very much. Thank you, David.
You're welcome. That's fun.
So, I always love doing it just because it's kind of interesting to see patterns. I always like seeing patterns. And typically, if they like the day, they like the sunrise, and they like white, or, there's certain patterns in there. And then during the conversation, we learned, I assumed you were going to say Rhone, and I assumed you were going to say cool climate by our conversation. So it's kind of just fun for me to see if I get a little,
we can get on the same wavelength here, right? Yeah.
Right. So before we go, can you just share with people where they can find your website, where you think is the best place to find you on social media, where you spend your most time if you're on social media, what your website is, and if you want to tell them one last thing about the pure wine.
Sure. I think the easiest way to learn about the company and about what we've talked about, you'll find some of the blogs. I've been writing blogs that explain some of the sulfite chemistries that we've talked about. I've got another histamine. It's actually a two-phase blog that I'm writing about the histamines and some of the stories we've been talking about here. On our website, it's drinkpurewine.com. Easy to remember, drinkpurewine.com. And also, we're very active in social media. We have a very large Instagram and Facebook following, Twitter also. We're actually just about everywhere wine in the Larkspur. We're in Total Wine and More, if you like to go there. We're in BevMo. We're in Albertsons. Literally, we're in about 3,000 locations in retail now. We're also in Europe on Amazon and Canada. We're in some retail and e-com. So that's really where we are now, is that we're just growing into the market. That's been one of our biggest challenges, is providing enough product for people, because it is a high demand, and people enjoy the product. It works for them, and really trying to prevent wine intolerance is really our passion. Because for me, and this is given a personal testimony, is that I think for wine is really the only healthy alcoholic beverage. And if I had a whiskey drinker here, I'd tell them the same thing. If I had a beer drinker, I'd tell them the same thing. Is that whiskey and beer do not help you live longer. Red wine does. And if we can bring people back into red wine, that's a good day for me. And that's really our mission at Pure Wine, is to help people live longer and enjoy wine at the same time.
That's awesome. That is really awesome. Thank you so very much. It's been, I loved talking to you and hearing your passion does shine through. And, you know, I always love sitting when I can talk to somebody and geek out on the science of science of anything, but especially the science of wine. So thank you very much for joining me and sharing your story and letting people hear how they can potentially enjoy wine again when they've been kind of scared away from it for a while.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, that's great. Well, Lori, it's been a pleasure. Hopefully I'll see you at some of the meetings coming up and at the wine meetings. I'd love to.
Okay, that would be wonderful.
We'll sit down and have a glass of red wine.
Absolutely. I would love it. I would love it. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Okay, goodbye.